had an eventful weekend. If you've been here for a bit, you know this about me. I'm a theater mom. I know. It gets a smaller applause than if I say I was a basketball mom or a football mom. But I know what it's like to be part of the elite few because I was a theater kid myself. So we're just like in full-blown theater. We are a part of this amazing group called CYT, Christian Youth Theater. It has a chapter here in Sacramento. Actually, a faithful member of our church, Bonnie Verner, heads up the Folsom chapter. So my daughter was in a production over the weekend. We finished it out. Closing weekend was yesterday. And we were in Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. Now, I had never seen that before. I didn't grow up in like a homeschooly Christian home. And so I didn't know about Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. How many of you have seen Seven Brides for Seven Brothers? Just show of hands. Yeah, right. There's a median age there. So here's the thing. I'm just going to leave this here, and you can go and watch it, and you can come to your own conclusions. We watched Seven Brides for Seven Brothers when we saw that that was the show that Lucy was going to audition for, so we watched it, and it was weird. I was like, what? There is a scene where these men put blankets over the women and cart them off to force them to marry them. And then they make an avalanche happen so nobody can rescue the women that they've just taken with the blankets over their heads. And I'm watching, my six-year-old son's like, that's what we do. We go put the blankets over the women. I'm like, no, we don't. This is a movie about what we don't do. What's happening? Moral of the story is, you know, is it going to redeem itself? And what is so interesting was as I was talking to our staff about this movie, it was the homeschooled Christian families that were like, oh yeah, that was the only movie we were allowed to watch. And I was like, that's the movie the homeschooled Christian communities chose. So Jonathan, you can explain that later. You guys just go watch that, and it's really sweet. It was good. So we wrapped it up, and up next is Willy Wonka. Willy Wonka, she'll be auditioning for Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. So the way that Banning has you pray for Lakes Games, I'm going to have you pray for auditions, all right? Yeah. Sarah knows what's up. Sarah's got me. Let's just jump right in. We're going to open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 12. You won't have to go very far, Genesis chapter 12. But if I could start off by saying this, church, I strongly believe that we are in a Genesis 11-12 moment as a people. As a society, I believe we are in a Genesis 11-12 moment. And what I mean by that is in Genesis chapter 11, you have people trying, it's the Tower of Babel. And you have mankind taking the role of God. And they are going to build themselves a tower that reaches heaven. They are going to be famous. They are going to show the world what man can do. They have taken greatness into their own hands, and they want to determine what is right and wrong themselves, and they are building a tower to show, basically, to show the world, we don't need God, we have us. And that's what's happening in Genesis chapter 11. It's all about the plans of man. Actually, Genesis chapter 3 to 11 is about how horrible things go when man is in charge, really. The fall happens and humankind just begins to disintegrate morally as corruption and sin prevails. And it all kind of climaxes to this Genesis 11 Tower of Babel moment. And I believe that's what we're seeing. Talk about a modern day Babel. Talk about a modern-day Tower of Babel, a modern-day group of people saying, we know what is right and wrong. We are going to build platforms. We are going to garner influence. We are going to make a name for ourselves. Guys, culture is playing God. We're messing with, we think we're the author and editor of life. We're messing with genetics. We're messing with creation. We are going to be famous, and we are going to show the world what we can do on our own. It's Genesis 11 happening out there. We think we know better. We're going to go cultivate Mars with Elon Musk because God must not have thought through Earth all the way. We need a new planet now. And I believe things are hitting a turning point. And in Genesis chapter 12, it opens up with a plot twist. Genesis 11, it starts to just crumble. God says, this is terrible. This is not going to lead to anything fruitful. And so he opens up with Genesis chapter 12, and it's a turning point of the entire biblical storyline. It's a plot twist as God comes to set things right. In Genesis chapter 12, it's important for us to look at because it's the beginning of salvation history and the birthplace of faith as we know it. D.A. Carson in the New Bible Commentary says, biblical genealogies indicate that Abram is the 10th generation from Shem, the son of Noah. It has been 10 generations since Yahweh spoke directly to anyone, according to the biblical account. Previously, God gave humanity a blessing and promise after the flood, but now, after the judgment of the Tower of Babel, God speaks a blessing to the world again through Abram. And what I mean by being in an 11-12 moment is I believe as society begins to crumble by trying to play God, and as they try to build modern day Babel, it's the internet. Just look. It's not hard to find. And it's unfruitful. And it's getting dark. And I believe we're in a Genesis 12 moment where God is coming, looking for Abrahamic faith, looking for a people who, like what we'll read today, who will operate in true faith and answer the call and obey what God is asking so that we can be blessing and hope to a lost and dying world. I believe God is coming just like in Genesis 12 to us today, saying it is time to live a life of faith and obey my word so that I can bless the nations of the earth through you. So let's read Genesis chapter 12, verses 1-9. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. I will. God says, I will 5 times. Genesis 3-11 is all about what man will do. God comes in chapter 12 and says, here's what I will do. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Then Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan. Abram passed through the land to the place Shechem, as far as the terebinth tree of Morah, and the Canaanites were there in the land. And then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land. And there he built an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. And then he goes on. He moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel, and he pitched his tent with Bethel on the west of Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. So Abram journeyed, going on still toward the south. If we're called to live a life of faith, which I'd say, right? The Bible shows, hard to argue. I don't need to make the point for that. We're called to live a life of faith. We need to look at the birthplace of faith. And we have to understand what faith really is. And faith is more than just hearing, as Abraham shows us here. Faith is not just hearing the word of God, it's obeying the word of God. The New Testament calls Abraham the father of faith. The New Testament references Abram all the time because it's the picture of faith that we need to have. And he makes it clear, the writer of Hebrews makes it clear, that Abraham only became the epitome of faith because he obeyed and went. He's called to go. God calls him. And when he hears God's call, that's not what actualizes faith. The Bible says what brought faith is when he went and obeyed. Look at Hebrews 11, verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when called to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. It doesn't say, by faith, Abraham heard the Lord. By faith, Abraham knew God was speaking to him. By faith, Abraham received the promise. It says, by faith, he obeyed and went. That is the evidence of true faith, is obedience. James 2 is all about the definition of faith and what faith is. And there is an active ingredient that manifests faith, and it's obedience. James 2:17 says, faith without works is dead. Faith without action isn't faith. And it's talking about Genesis 12. Genesis 12 is this lived out through a man. If Genesis 12:4 went any differently, we don't have the father of faith. Genesis 12:4, Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him. Another translation says, so Abram obeyed and went. Without the obey and went, we don't have the father of faith, and we don't have the song, Father Abraham has many sons, many sons has father. We are not the sons and daughters of Abraham without 12:4, which is more than hearing, it's obeying. It's action with the hearing. And this is the kind of faith that God is calling us to. This is the kind of faith we're called to live in. How do I know when I have faith? It's when I obey. You don't have faith when you hear the word of God. Your faith is manifested when you follow through with what he's asking of you. We're cold plungers now, Derek and I. We cold plunge. You guys know about cold plunge? It's a phenomena hitting the earth right now. Science is telling you, you need to sit in ice water for a couple minutes and you will be healed and healthy and beautiful and rich and famous. No, I'm kidding. But it's healthy for you. It's good for you. They're saying you sit in ice water. Athletes have known this for a long time. There's something scientific. It's good to sit in the cold water, but it's about what happens to your body after you get out of the cold water. When the natural process of your body warming itself up does all kinds of cellular regeneration, and it's good for your fights free radicals, and it has all of these benefits physically, and then it has all these benefits emotionally and hormonally, and all this good comes from sitting in cold water. So Derek discovers this. It's really big with men right now, because you're a man if you can sit in cold water, right, Ben? So he was cold plunging in our pool. Well, starts with like really cold showers. He's ending his showers with like 3 minutes of ice cold water, and then he moves to sitting in the pool, and he's like, I want an ice bath. And I'm like, well, we got a tub. He's like, no, you got to have this ice bath. So I'm not going to buy an ice bath, but my parents said, what do you guys want for Christmas? We want to bless you with something. Now, I'm the kind of girl, I don't know if any of you women are like me, but I'm like, anything you can do, I can do better. So, can't have a baby. So, I'm like, I'm going to cold plunge too. And so, I tell my mom, I said, okay, I sent her this link to this ice bath, portable little ice bath. You blow it up, put it together, put ice cold water in it. And my parents are, you know, blue collar, Midwest. They're like, what is that? I said, it's an ice bath for cold plunging. She goes, my dad's like, you want to sit in cold water on purpose? And they're from near Chicago. He goes, you can come home and dip in Lake Michigan. You got all the ice water you need. You know, they're just so like, what are you guys doing? So we get the ice bath. We set it up. And Derek's been doing this in the pool. So he's ready to go. And he goes, it feels so good. And it's all about these like mental hurdles you have to overcome too. This neurosurgeon did all this research. And he goes, it's about the mental walls you have to overcome. The first mental wall is you get in your swimsuit. Second is you get to the water. Third, you have to get in the water. Then you got to go all the way to your shoulders, you know, and it's good for you to overcome these mental hurdles. I'm like, yeah, it's good for me. So anything you can do, I can do better. So he gets it, and my kids get out there, and they're like, come on, Mom, you can do it. And I'm like, you know, it's January 20th. I'm in a swimsuit outside. I'm like, this is it. This is enough. I'm fine. I'm, you know, but I want to be able to say, I cold plunge. Because my husband can say it, so I want to be able to say it. And so he fills it up with hose water, and my kids are like, come on, Mom, you can do it, you can do it. Derek goes, the first 30 seconds are going to be awful. I'm like, no, I think all of the seconds are going to be awful. And I get in the white ice water on January 20th outside, and I'm just like, oh, my gosh, this is horrible. Girls, you've shaved your legs. All your hair is back, you know. I'm just like, this is awful. And I could not get to, I couldn't get my shoulders under, so I just sat there, and I did 3 minutes. Did I do 3 minutes? I did 2 minutes. Oh, all right. I did 2 minutes. Derek did 13. And I did 2 minutes. And I couldn't get my shoulders under, but I will next time. But I can say I'm a cold plunger because I got in the water. You can't say you cold plunge. You can't tell me that you're reaping the benefits of cold plunge until you get in the water. Likewise, you can't tell me you have faith just because you know a bunch of the Bible. You can't tell me you have faith because you give prophetic words and you hear from the voice of God. You can tell me you have faith when you obey what he's asking of you. That's great you have an ice bath. Get in it. God gives Abram this promise. All the nations of the earth are going to be blessed through you. But he doesn't get it without obedience. He doesn't get it just because God said it. Man, man, the promise and the inheritance of the fullness of Jesus sound amazing, don't they? He died for your healing. He died for your life abundantly. He died for your freedom. You have an inheritance. You have a promise that you can access. That's awesome. How do I get it? By faith. What's faith? Obeying. It's not just hearing. But what happens is many of us want the promise without the process. We want the inheritance without the obedience because the ask of God is much too crazy. Because to actually obey, it is risky, it feels scary, it doesn't make sense. And what happens when we get stuck in that place is here we are, depressed, living in Ur, but we wish we had a land flowing with milk and honey, but we don't want to leave our hometown. God says the promise is out there beyond your comfort. The promise is out there beyond the familiar. Abram, you're going to be a blessing to all the families of the earth. But you got to get out of Ur. I am going to be your protector. And I'm going to redeem your story. And I'm going to heal your relational trauma. But I need you to love unconditionally. I am going to be your provider and meet every need. I'm going to take care of you. But I need you to live generously. I'm going to speak to you. I'm gonna reveal my will to you. I am going to tell you what I have for you, but I need you to get up on Sunday morning and get to church with the people of God. We want what he has, but it comes by faith, and faith is hearing and obeying. And sometimes faith means I go into the wilderness, which stinks. The wilderness is two things, right? Abraham, his faith led him to the wilderness. We're going to talk about that. It leads him out of his hometown into the wilderness. And the wilderness is two things. It is inconvenient and it is unknown. You know what's awesome? It says Abraham was 75 years old. And the context of Abram's life is he is in Ur, which is it's the center of a wealthy empire in Mesopotamia. Abraham he's settled. He's 75. He's worked hard. He's acquired people. He has herds. His father has set him up for success. He's the patriarch of the family, and his father has died. And now it's Abram's turn to run the family. He's like good. He's 75. This is no big deal to ask a 25-year-old to get up and leave everything behind, right? But God comes at 75. I just want to encourage anybody who feels like they missed it. Your call isn't in your timeline. It's in God's timeline, which isn't dictated by what we know. He calls Abram at 75 years old. Abram is settled. You want to talk about uprooting and inconvenient? His 401k just kicked in, baby. He's ready for Florida and Mai Tais on a Wednesday morning. And God's like, start over. But I got it going on. This is awesome. I'm in the city of opportunity. I'm settled, God. I don't need a new adventure. Get out of your hometown. Get out of that bustling city full of opportunity. Get out of all that wealth that you've acquired. It's inconvenient to live a life of faith. Super inconvenient. I don't know if you've ever been really inconvenienced by a good friend. Yeah. Years ago, we, in our early 20s, our best friends at the time asked us, they're not our best friends anymore because of this story. Our best friends at the time asked us to help them move. Well, you already know, if someone's asking you to help them move, you know, you're a real one. Now, these friends of ours weren't super organized people. They're not like me, right? Like, if I ask you to help me move, anybody who knows me, you can bet on this. You're going to come to color-coded boxes with a timeline. The truck will be ready. We will be in an hour and a half. I'll give you your pizza. Thank you. Goodbye. Okay? That is what I expect when someone says, can you help me move? Yes, I will help you move boxes. Well, we show up to these friends' houses, and they're like, hey, help us move. Yeah. We get there. Derek and I walk in. Nothing's packed. Nothing's packed. Guys, they don't have boxes. She's like, I gotta run to Home Depot and get boxes. Here, she hands me a laundry basket, real story, a laundry basket where she's kept all these random tools. She goes, will you go disassemble the master bed and take down the curtains in all the rooms? And I'm like, you don't even have the right tools. Nothing's in boxes. You didn't want me to help you move. You want me to pack up your house. This is why they're not our friends anymore. No. So, and it's just Derek and I. And so we stayed. We didn't leave them. We stayed and we spent, and trucks come in 2 hours, the whole house, nothing's packed. So we stayed and we packed them up and we got them moved. Do you know why? Because we loved them. My willingness to be inconvenienced will correlate directly with my commitment to the relationship. I am so willing to be inconvenienced for those that I deeply love and the relationships that I am committed to. What happens, church, when God shows up and asks you to be inconvenienced for him? My willingness to be inconvenienced will reveal my level of commitment to him. You might not like what that says about you. You might be really stoked right now. I don't know. The ask for Abram is massive. We just lose sight in our culture. You know, we are a very mobile, individualistic culture. And they weren't like that. In the ancient Near East, they're tribal people, yeah. Right? And when you settle, it's a big deal. And it's like you just pick up and just go wherever. And so he's asked, and the details in the word, it's so specific. This is what it's telling us. Listen, he says, I want you to go out of your country, from your family, from your father's house. I read one scholar said every detail gets more and more intimate because he's asking, he's looking for real faith. Abram, are you really willing to sacrifice? I don't want you to just get out of your country. I want you to get out of your father's house. I don't want you to just get out of your father's house. I want you to leave your family. With each successive detail, he's making it sharper and sharper, clearer and clearer. Abram, I am asking you to risk everything. To risk everything in that time and do what God was asking is almost like a death sentence. To go out into the wilderness and become nomadic from being established and to become a nomadic people, unprotected, into the wilderness. All that to say, it is inconvenient what God is asking of him. And I think many of us would stop right there. Leave my family, leave my comfort, leave my hometown for the wilderness? Absolutely not. Good thing Jesus doesn't ask us of that anymore, right? Oops, Matthew 10:37. New Testament, Jesus goes, I need you to leave your father and your mother and take up your cross and leave everything behind to follow me. God is calling us beyond our comfort, beyond familiar territory, so that we can walk in the fullness that he has for us. And not just so we can get stuff, not just so we can get a bunch of blessing. The fullness of what he has for you is just knowing Christ Jesus. Paul says, I count everything garbage. I count it all a loss. It is a total wash apart from knowing Jesus, my Lord. What happens when you live a life of true faith and you're obedient to inconvenient calls is you become aware of Christ Jesus. You know him better. Your intimacy deepens. Your dependence deepens. Notice what happens as Abraham journeys from home into the wilderness. He makes an altar. Your obedience should lead you to true worship. But when we're so obsessed and committed to our ways, when we are more faithful to building our life our way, with our methods and our measures and our metrics and our standards, when we're over there just building Babel our way, we can miss or just straight up deny the call to live in faith. And then you lose the Abrahamic covenant, which is everything. It is everything. We are here today because this man chose to have true faith. This is why I say it's Genesis 11:12 moment, because you can stay in Genesis 11 and you can keep laying bricks for Babel, or you can choose to pick up everything and follow where he's asking you to go. But you can't have both. It's 11 or 12, and I think this is the moment that we are in history. The other thing about wilderness is inconvenient, guys, and it's unknown. Here's what trips me up about this. God's like, go. Abraham's like, where? He goes, I don't know. I'll show you. I'm like, I'll show you. He doesn't say, I don't know. God knows everything. Okay. A land I will show you. The only detail God gives him is I am with you. Church, Becky, will we follow him when the only promise that we have is his presence with us? I'm amazed at this passage. I'm just sitting in this for, I've been sitting in this for months. Genesis 12, it's the linchpin of the Bible story. Everything changes after Genesis 12. It is the beginning of salvation history. I see some emphatic nods here. Yes, it is the it's critical. This is God's rescue plan to save humanity through the blessing of Abraham. It is where God steps in and he goes, that's it. 3 through 11, we're done. Plans of man, we're done. I am coming, and this is what I'm going to do. Here's the promise for Israel. Here's the promised land. Here's the future. You would think a plan that grand and important would have, like, more details. I'm like, all right, this is a big one, God. Abraham's rewriting history. This is important. What's the detail? God says, I'll show you. God doesn't specify because he's looking for real faith. It's not real faith if you know all the details. It's not true obedience if you know how it's all going to work out. So he's searching. Who's the man? Who's the one that will follow even when he doesn't know? Who's the one that will be inconvenienced and go into the unknown if all I say is, I promise I'll show you and I will be with you? How many of us, I just think, how many times I myself, I've begged God for direction. We fast for 21 days. Y'all grumpy for the first 21 days of the year because you want God to tell you your word for the year. What's my word for the year? It's just growth. Like, yeah, that's good. It should be your word every year. We're fasting for our word. God, tell me, or a situation, crisis comes, you're like, God, I will do whatever, just speak. I'm gonna come to conference after conference, and I'm hitting up every prophetic intercessor. Give me a word. I don't know what to do. I feel lost. And God's like, I'll tell you. And we're like, okay, I'll do whatever you say, God, whatever you say, as long as it all works out for me. As long as I know every single detail. I'll obey when it makes sense. I'll obey when I can rationalize it. I'll obey as long as it's very, very detailed, exactly where I'm going, when am I going, who am I going with. God goes, what happens if I just say, come and I'll show you? Abraham didn't go, where? How many miles? How much do I gotta pack? When am I coming back? Who's coming with me? Who's gonna survive? What's the timeline here? I'm 75, clock's ticking. He's like, I'll show you. True faith, I'll show you. It's unknown, it's scary. Wilderness is scary. None of us like the wilderness. That's why it's a hobby. That's why you go to REI and you spend all your money to live like someone who doesn't have a home. The wilderness is scary, you guys. If we all loved the wilderness, we'd all be Bear Grylls. But instead, we like to watch Bear Grylls from the comfort of our home eating Cheetos, and we hope we never have to crawl inside a dead animal carcass or decide whether or not to drink my own urine or choose if I chew or swallow a leech. I was watching Bear Grylls. My daughter's here. She loves Bear Grylls, and he's on Netflix now. Bear Grylls has kind of gone soft, though, because I'm going to tell you an old school Bear Grylls story. So she's watching this Netflix special he has where it's Choose Your Own Adventure, and you get to interactively decide what he does. I do not like the wilderness. Watching Bear Grylls, I just cringe. And every time, even though he's been around for years and he's proven himself, every time I think in the back of my mind, are you really going to do this? So she's watching this one, and she goes, Mom, you got to choose. Does he swallow the leech or chew it? I'm like, neither. What? He has caviar in the private jet, honey. Nat Geo flew him. He's a millionaire. Do you want to chew the leech or swallow it whole? And I'm like, I want to see him swallow it whole. So he swallows this leech, and homeboy gets it stuck in his throat. The leech sticks to the inside of his throat. He starts choking. I'm like, I just killed Bear Grylls. Oh my gosh, honey, rewind it. Choose, chew. And he grabs a twig, makes some makeshift pliers, and pulls the leech out of his mouth. This is real. We're watching this. Before I had ever seen Bear Grylls, before he went, soft and mainstream, he had these specials on TV on the history, I don't know, Nat Geo or whatever channel he was on. Derek and I are dating. I'm 15. I've never seen Bear Grylls. He was kind of just becoming whatever he is. And Derek goes, check this guy out. And we're watching. I'm like, who is he? He goes, my hero. I'm like, okay. So he's in the tundra. I've never seen Bear Grylls. He's in the tundra. And he goes, all right. I need sustenance. I'm going to set a trap and get a reindeer. And I'm like, well, that seems kind of mean. So he gets this reindeer. I'm going to have to really soften this story up for those watching on stream. And I have children in the room. He catches a reindeer. And I'm like, that's so cute. Derek's like, shut. Watch. And I go, what's he going to do with the reindeer? And I'm looking at the TV and I'm looking at Derek. I'm going, why did he catch a reindeer? It's cute. Like Donner and Blitzen, like it's Rudolph, this furry reindeer. And it's struggling on the tree. He's caught it. And I go, oh, I feel bad for him. Derek goes, no, it's about to get, it's going to get good. And it's like, okay. I'm like, what's he going to do with the reindeer? And also, what's he going to do on national television with the reindeer? You can't hurt this animal on national television. The rules were different in 2004. He's like, all right. And he's like, arm around the reindeer. I'm like, don't make friends with it if you're going to hurt it. Are you just going to cuddle it because it's warm? I'm like, just cuddle the reindeer. I have no idea what's about to happen. He takes a pocket knife out, slits the reindeer's throat. I'm like, oh my gosh, my eyes. Derek's like, it's so awesome. And Derek's standing up. He's like, oh my gosh. I go, what kind of illegal film? Who are you? He's like, hold on, it's about to get better. Blood, purple blood's pouring out. He's like, all right. I'm like, why did you do that? How does that help you? He sticks his hand and pulls the heart out, drinks the blood. I mean, we're talking, you think if you're, I don't know, if you're from that generation where Ozzy bit the bird on the stage and it was all, this is great, next level. He bites Rudolph's heart and he squirts. And I'm like, I think I'm crying. I'm mortified. What are you showing me? You sick psycho, like what? Who is this man? He has no future. He needs to be arrested right now. I'm calling PETA right now. And then he takes a bite out of the heart. And he's like, yeah, sustenance in the tundra. I was just like, oh. Here's the thing. The wilderness. Bear Grylls. He's an ideal we like to watch, not a reality we want to live in. The wilderness is something we like to observe. It's not a reality we willingly go into for life. But God calls us into wilderness. True faith will lead us into wilderness, which is unknown, which can be scary, which isn't secure. We don't want to survive the wilderness. We want to skirt around it. Here's the thing. Abraham doesn't get the blessing apart from wilderness. You don't get the promised land without going through the wilderness. The wilderness is God's miracle working ground. He doesn't get the word of the Lord for his life, staying where he's comfortable. He gets it in the wilderness. So I'd just like to ask you to consider, maybe your inheritance isn't in your current empire. Maybe you're going to have to get a little uncomfortable and venture out into the wilderness with God, knowing he's with you. Maybe you got to go camping. Dixon Slater, first service, he goes, please, God, send me camping. He's the REI guy, you know? I could have keys come on up and we can get communion ready. Derek, actually, you guys could come on up for a song. Here's what I believe. I believe God's showing up to us in this hour. I think God's showing up today. Just like he showed up to Abram, and he's asking us to be a part of his plan, his way, for his glory. But he's wondering, will you enter into a faith obedience agreement? Will I find Abrahamic people on the earth who are willing to go into inconvenience, who are willing to go into wilderness, who are willing to go into uncomfortability? Abraham didn't go where he felt passionate. Don't you love millennials? I don't know what generation. Millennials, is it me? They're just like, I just want to go where, like, I feel passionate. Just, like, want to go to, like, Nashville. God's calling me to Hawaii. I'm like, really? God loves you. You're like, Becky, you sound bitter. Yeah, I was called to Sacramento. I could have gone anywhere. You know, it's funny. People are like, I'm in this season of life where a lot of my friends are going and planting and starting things. And I'm not, it's not a commentary on their obedience, right? You go where God's called you, but I think there is way more of a focus on where do I want to go? Abraham wasn't like, hey, the land of opportunities. All my friends are going, I'm so passionate about the wilderness. Oh, I love it. I just want to go and like get a latte in the wilderness. It's like really cultured. There's a good music scene out there. I need to stop. Do you know what I'm saying? You get it, right? Yeah. Like, you get it. My family, they're like, you know, Indiana, Midwest, conservative morals and good people. They're like, what are you doing in California? Just objectively looking. They're like, you're raising your kids in California. You could go anywhere. I'm like, if I leave, who will stay? I'm on mission. I'm not passionate about California. I'm called to California. It doesn't matter what culture is doing. We are here because this is where God has called us, and he needs Abrahams living in the land of the wild, being a blessing to a lost and dying world. You don't go where you're passionate. You don't go where it's all lined up. You don't go where you know the outcome. You go where God has called you. That's living by faith. We are so comfortable, we are so soft, we are so committed to our own ways that we won't lay down bricks of Babel for where God is calling us. There is a land flowing with milk and honey. There is an inheritance for you. But you gotta get up. And you think, it's a big ask. Could I get communion? You guys could pass communion. You'd think the ask is the ask of God to Abram is huge, right? I'm thinking he knows he's leaving everything. And then we know the rest of the story. When you know the rest of the story, you go, wow, of course, right? The yes is easy. When you know the end of the story, you realize what Abraham was getting in return. He'd leave that 10 times over. You think God's asking you to give something up that matters. You think you'll lose everything? You think you'll really miss out if you truly obey what he's asking you to do? If you really let go of what he's asking you to let go of, you think you're missing out. You have no idea what you might be attaining. For your kids, for your grandkids, for the world. Abraham, you're gonna be a blessing to every nation. Do you know we are here? I was radically saved from a life of darkness because Abraham said, yes, I can access Jesus. He goes on, he's the lineage of Jesus. He's the patriarch, he's the father of our faith. That's why there's such a big deal about him in the New Testament. His decision echoes for eternity. But if he would have been worried about leaving some materials behind, if he'd have been worried about getting uncomfortable, if he would have been afraid about getting dirty in the wilderness, we don't stand here today. If you believe God, if you believe God and leave behind your way of building, to follow Jesus, you will become a blessing to others. The richness of the Spirit of God and the blessing of Abraham will flood every area of your life. And we will stand like a city shining on a hill for a lost and dying and broken world. The favor of God follows the faithful. I just want to end with this. If you take communion is reserved for those who have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So if you have not done that, it's not to exclude you. We just ask that you would withhold because this is for those that have come into covenant with the Lord, as their Savior. Get your communion ready. I'm going to have you just take it on your own. And as Derek leads us in a chorus, I just want you to reflect on your life. I want you to reflect on your life and think of the sacrifice of Jesus. What he gave up, his faithful obedience, allowing you to stand righteous before God today. And as you remember his obedience, as you remember his body and blood, just submit your own life and say, God, where are you calling me? Where do I think I'm too old to venture out? Where do I think it's too risky? Where am I too comfortable? Where have I been denying stepping into a life of true faith? By your mercy today, show us.